Hachette Audio presents To Sanctify the World, The Vital Legacy of Vatican II. Written by George Weigel. Read by Stephen Arthur. For God sent the Son into the world, not to condemn the world, but that the world might be saved through him. John chapter 3, verse 17. Jesus Christ is the great hidden key to human history and the part we play in it. Pope Paul VI, homily in Manila, November 29, 1970. For John, and in memory of Linda, 1953 to 2020. Introduction. Reimagining Vatican II. The Second Ecumenical Council of the Vatican, Vatican II, in the familiar shorthand, was the most important event in the history of Catholicism since the Council of Trent responded to the various Protestant reformations of the 16th century. The world shook the Catholic Church severely in the next 400 years. The various European enlightenments, the French Revolution, the 19th century assault on the papacy, and the church by secular powers, three totalitarianisms, two world wars, the Cold War, and decolonization all had profound effects. Yet viewed from inside the household of faith, no Catholic event since the Council of Trent had so dramatic an impact on world Catholicism as the Second Vatican Council. And virtually none has been so contentious. 60 years after it solemnly opened on October 11, 1962, the meaning of Vatican II remained controverted, and sometimes bitterly controverted, throughout the world church. Some contemporary Catholic voices, no longer limited to the disaffected elderly but now including deeply committed young Catholics, claim that the Council was a fatal concession to the modern world that should be repudiated or quietly buried. Much of the German-speaking Catholic world seems to think that the spirit of Vatican II was an invitation to reinvent Catholicism as another liberal Protestant denomination. In Germany and elsewhere, prominent Catholic academics regard the Council as an unfortunate compromise that failed to achieve its great promise. In contrast, the new and vibrant local churches of sub-Saharan Africa consider Vatican II a great blessing, the Magna Carta for their tremendous growth. These are arguments at the macro level. Beneath them are the practical issues of daily Catholic life with which the people of the church regularly contend. How should Catholics celebrate Mass so that their worship enriches their lives and empowers them for mission? What does Catholicism have to say to the sexual revolution and the erosion of the family throughout the West? How is the faith to be transmitted to future generations? And what, precisely, is to be handed on? What, if anything, estranges a Catholic from the Church? What is Catholicism's response to contested issues of society, culture, and public life? And who speaks for the Church in these fields? How does the Church recover from the plague of clerical sexual abuse, reform itself, and bring healing and justice to the victims of these grave sins and crimes? To many, including most of the cardinal electors at the conclave of 2013, the pontificates of John Paul II, 1978 through 2005, and Benedict XVI, 2005 through 2013, settled the debate over what Vatican II taught and how that teaching should be embodied in the Church's pastoral practice. Many of the old questions and controversies about the Council burst back to the surface of Catholic life during the pontificate of Pope Francis, however. Relitigating those arguments has raised the temperature of Catholic debate beyond the boiling point on more than one occasion since the newly elected Argentine and Jesuit Pope stepped out onto the Vatican Basilica's Loggia of Blessings and greeted the crowds in St. Peter's Square on the evening of March 13, 2013. This is not healthy. A Catholic Church endlessly debating what Vatican II meant is a church disempowered in its proclamation of the gospel of Jesus Christ and disengaged from its service to an ever more fractious postmodern world. A reimagining of the Council's purpose and a fresh encounter with its teaching is in order. What precisely was Vatican II? Vatican II, the actual conciliar assembly, met in four formal sessions, technically known as periods, in the autumn months of 1962, 1963, 1964, and 1965. The pre-conciliar preparatory process was also a part of Vatican II, however, and so was the work done on behalf of the Council during the months between its formal periods. And given the ongoing post-conciliar debates over its purpose and meaning, it seems fair to say that the event of Vatican II continues 6 decades after the Council opened. It all began on January 25, 1959, when John XXIII, a newly elected pope chosen as an elderly placeholder, attended a service at the Basilica of St. Paul outside the walls during an octave of prayer for Christian unity. There, the genial, octogenarian pontiff stunned the church and the world by announcing that he would summon an ecumenical council, a deliberative assembly of all the world's Catholic bishops. The shock came in part because some Catholic thinkers imagined that this venerable form of ecclesiastical gathering had been consigned to the dustbin of history in 1870 by the First Vatican Council's definition of the Pope's infallible teaching authority. Others imagined that the unprecedented centralization of church authority in Rome since Vatican I had rendered ecumenical councils irrelevant. Still, others wondered why a seemingly rock-solid and self-confident religious institution should conduct a rigorous self-examination. John XXIII, whose affability could conceal a penetrating insight into the church's mid-20th century situation, thought differently. The event of Vatican II continued through a multi-year preparatory process, including an extensive consultation with bishops, superiors of religious orders of men, and pontifical faculties in Catholic universities around the world during what was known as the Council's anti-preparatory period. The results of those consultations were then sifted through various pre-conciliar committees dominated by officials of the Roman Curia, the Church's central administrative bureaucracy. In this preparatory phase, the committees wrote draft texts for a council that members of the Curia and many of the world's bishops imagined would finish its work in a few months. Yet within days of the Council's formal opening in October 1962, those expectations were falsified by events, and it became clear that the Council would continue for some time. John XXIII died on June 3, 1963, between Vatican II's first and second periods. The conclave that elected his successor, Pope Paul VI, should be considered another moment in the event of Vatican II, as the question of whether the Council would continue, and if so, to what ends, was part of a rather bruising electoral process. More than a conclave happened between the end of Vatican II's first period on December 8, 1962, and the opening of its second period on September 29, 1963, however, during the months that conciliar historians call an intercession. Conciliar commissions drafted documents to replace those that had been found inadequate during the Council's first period. Bishops and their theological advisors held consequential conversations about the proper way forward, and the new pope took steps to ensure that the Council would continue its work in an orderly fashion. This pattern of conciliar commissions continuing to draft and redraft documents and groups of bishops consulting with each other on the issues repeated itself during the 1963 to 1964 and 1964 to 1965 intercessions, with important consequences for the Second Vatican Council's substantive product, its 16 documents. From the narrowest of viewpoints, that of its formal periods, the Second Vatican Council thus began on October 11, 1962, when John XXIII solemnly opened the proceedings with an address of great consequence, and concluded on December 8, 1965, when Paul VI formally declared the council closed at the end of its fourth period. A more accurate view of Vatican II as a historical event would mark it as beginning with John XXIII's announcement of his intention to summon a council on January 25, 1959. Note that the council as event included its ante-preparatory and preparatory phases, 1959 through 1962. Its formal periods, in autumn months of 1962 through 1965, and the intercessions of 1963, 1964, and 1965, and mark its conclusion as December 8, 1965, when, after the closing ceremonies, some 2,400 bishops poured out of the Vatican Basilica, then left Rome and returned to their diocese. Even that widening of the historical lens is insufficient, though. For Vatican II,
we hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.